So some historians called the Civil War a rich man's war and a poor man's fight. Can you guess why they may have called it that? Well, we're going to take a look here. Make sure and jot this down into your notes. There will be an essay question on this information. We're going to take a look at the North and the South, and you can put this into a graphic organizer type format. In the North, there was a draft. So the North drafted soldiers for their armies, meaning that the Northern government could basically order people to serve in the army, whether they wanted to or not. And if they refused, they could be sentenced to prison time. The South also drafted soldiers for their armies. However, in the North, a rich man could pay a fee or hire someone to avoid military service. And in the South, men overseeing 20 or more slaves were exempt or didn't have to serve in the military. The poor had no way out of the draft, so the poor had to fight. And in the South, the poor had no way out of the draft, so the poor fight. So what you have happening here basically is wealthy people in the North and in the South would talk a lot about the war, talk a lot about defeating the other side, but when it came to actually fighting, in many cases it was the poor man that had to go and do the actual fighting, and this is why. This is a photo of the Emancipation Proclamation in Washington, D.C., in the National Archives. These are Civil War reenactors having their pictures taken with the actual document, Emancipation Proclamation, which you may have heard of before. And this is a proclamation made by Abraham Lincoln during the Civil War. And this kind of summarizes, this is an excerpt from the Emancipation Proclamation. What Lincoln said, and he said this to the North and the South. He said, quote, "On the first day of January in the year of our Lord 1863, all persons held as slaves within any state or part of a state whose people shall be in rebellion against the United States shall be then thenceforward and forever free," unquote. And Lincoln said that in the Emancipation Proclamation, and what this is saying is that if there is any state or part of a state that is in rebellion against the Union, actually fighting against the United States, slaves in those territories are free. Now, there were border states, Maryland, West Virginia, and some other ones, that this didn't necessarily apply to. It was the states that were in rebellion against the Union. In those states, the slaves were free. Now there are some problems with that, as you might imagine. We'll take a look at those. The effects of the Emancipation Proclamation. It was a military order that freed slaves only in the Confederacy, not in border states. It was mainly symbolic. The government could not enforce it in the South. As you know, the North was at war with the South, so even though Lincoln stated that slaves in the Confederacy were free, it didn't mean that the Confederacy just freed their slaves. Of course, they didn't do that. They were fighting for their way of life, which included slavery. So it was mainly symbolic. On New Year's Eve, 1862, African Americans and abolitionists rejoiced. Even though slavery still existed in the South, the proclamation encourages slaves to escape when Union soldiers approached. So, in many ways, the Emancipation Proclamation kind of inspired slaves in the South to escape, to try to meet up with Union soldiers in the South so that they could make their way to the North where they would be officially free. And the loss of slaves in the South severely hurt their ability to wage war. Now, we know the vast advantages the North had. We took a look at a chart that showed you really the incredible advantages that the North had over the South before the war started. So you may ask yourself, why did it take 4 years for the North to win? And that was because the South had some advantages. First, the South had far superior military leadership. The military leaders in the South had been highly trained in tactics and strategies on how to win a war. Some of the finest military academies in the United States are still to this day in the South. So the military leadership was superior in the South. The South had home field advantage. To win, the Union had to physically conquer the South. They had to go to the South to defeat them. And much of the South was wilderness. Establishing supply lines was nearly impossible. So if Northern soldiers ventured into the South to put down the rebellion, they had to have supply lines coming from the North where they would receive food and clothing and medical supplies. And because so much of the South was wilderness, it was very difficult to do this. There were far more Southerners experienced with guns than Northerners. And Southerners were very eager to go into battle and were loyal to the Confederacy. So we call the rebel yell mentality. Many Confederates couldn't wait to go into battle and fight for their way of life. They were very, very kind of pumped up. And because they were so invested in winning this war, because it would preserve their way of life, that gave them an advantage over the Northerners. Now, how did the North eventually win? Well, this is how. And this chart should look familiar. You've seen it before. At the end of the day, or rather after 4 years of fighting, the advantages that the North had were just far superior to the South. The North was just too wealthy, too many railroad lines, too many factories, workers in industry, population. The South just couldn't defeat the much larger, better prepared North. I'll talk a little bit about the home front of the Civil War. The home front is what takes place during a war off the battlefield, not actually where battles are taking place. For example, women played a role in the Civil War, but on the home front, not actually in battles. So what roles did women take during the Civil War? They had to do men's jobs while they were off fighting. They raised money for the war effort on both sides. And frequently they became nurses. What impact did the economy have on the Civil War? Well, income taxes were raised. This means that any time someone got paid, they had to pay a tax on their income, on the money that they received, and taxes were raised to fight the war. The South suffered severe shortages of goods. Obviously, fighting a war against the much larger North took a toll on the South. Some industries benefited from the war. And I'm going to let you think about what industries might have benefited from a war. And maybe you can share those in class. What role did African Americans play in the Civil War? Well, Lincoln was concerned that African Americans would not be welcomed into the army by white soldiers, and this was why it wasn't until a few years into the war that the 54th All-Black Regiment was actually formed. Lincoln was worried that that could cause tension between the African American soldiers and the white soldiers. As the war worsened in the South, discrimination increased. African Americans were recognized as free by the President of the United States in the Emancipation Proclamation. It may not have done much in the South, but it was a huge victory that the actual President declared the slaves free. Now, there's a legal term you should be familiar with. It's called the writ of habeas corpus. And what that says, for the most part, is A writ of habeas corpus is a court order to produce a person in court so that the court can determine the legality of his or her detention. It's part of the due process that every citizen has a right to. In the United States, anytime someone is arrested, they have a right to due process. They have a right to tell their story in front of a court. And that's what a writ of habeas corpus is. It says that a person has the right to go in front of a court before they're just thrown in jail. Now that's going to be important because during the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln suspended the writ of habeas corpus. So basically during this time period, Lincoln declared it legal for people to be put in jail without due process, without the benefit of going in front of a court first. And the reason he did this is he claimed that in times of emergency, the power of the president must increase to preserve peace and national security. Some important presidential decisions made during the Civil War. The writ of habeas corpus was suspended. Men were forced into the army by the draft. And Lincoln issues the Emancipation Proclamation. Now this concludes this video on the home front during the Civil War. And the next video, which will conclude this unit, takes place after Abraham Lincoln is assassinated at Ford's Theater, which is right here. You can go visit Ford's Theater in Virginia. And after Lincoln is assassinated, and soon after that, when the North wins the Civil War with the surrender at Appomattox Courthouse, the South is utterly destroyed. These are some photographs of the Confederacy after the Civil War. And this is going to lead to our next unit, which is titled Reconstruction, which basically means the Reconstruction of the South. Again, if you have any questions or need any clarification, please see me as soon as possible.